Thank you, everyone, for coming. Simon Winchester and Pico Iyer, I'm sure you've seen throughout the weekend here. And although they've been friends for a very long time, they tell me this is the first time they've ever shared a stage.
Yeah. Mm.
So we'll give them 6 rounds and maybe a technical knockout, I think is the judgment in question. Throughout the whole history of humanity until, you know, 150 years ago, most ordinary men didn't travel any farther from their homes than they could walk in a matter of a few days. While that's changed significantly, thanks in part to technology, still only about a third of Americans hold passports. And that number is double from a few years ago, once the United States decided you had to have passports to go to Canada and Mexico. So we're talking about travel as a concept, as a practical matter, the difference between a tourist and a traveler, and not just how you look at the world as you pass through it, but what you think of it when you come home from your travels. So, gentlemen, I suppose that's an easy way to start, is the difference between travel and tourism from your points of view.
Who's going to start?
Well, you guys know each other. You've worked this out already.
Pico.
Okay. I would say a traveler is a tourist with pretensions. In other words, I think both a tourist and a traveler can potentially have very circumscribed views. If you're only staying in 5-star hotels, you're only seeing a small part of the country. But if you're only staying in 0-star hotels, you're only seeing a small part of it too, even though you're calling yourself a traveler and saying how close you are to the native, so to speak. So I've never been much interested in the distinction between them. I always call myself a tourist, because I think if a tourist is somebody who's saving up all his money and time to go with open-eyed curiosity and see the world, that's a great thing to be.
I was once in, I was leading a group of British tourists through Rajasthan about 15 years ago. And we turned up in Jodhpur, I think it was, and the hotel reservation had broken down. So I had these 10 elderly people, British, intelligent, nice people. And I didn't really know what to do with them. But I knew one fellow in Jodhpur who was a minor Maharaja. He was called the Zemindar of Rohit. And I looked him up in the phone book, and the servant said he was attending a cricket match between Bikaner and Jodhpur at the local stadium. So I left all my charges having tea in the hotel, saying, I'm sure we'll come up with some way of sorting out this situation. And there was this minor Maharaja, and we hadn't seen him for 10 years or so, but he was very pleased, very polite. Maybe he didn't remember who I was. But I said, I've got this problem. He said, I have this castle in a little village called Rohit. So I tell you what, I'll get my car and my daughters and the Labradors, and you follow in your minibus with these people. So we drive. This could be a very long story, but it won't be. We went down the main road near towards Udaipur and came to this tiny village, and we threaded our way through these little streets. And then there was this fort with a huge gate with elephant spikes on it, you know, and 2 Rajput soldiers outside, and they saluted and opened the door, and there was this vista of green lawns and the Malis cutting the roses and things, and all these tourists got in there. And the servants said, well, we'll make up rooms. And they'd never had guests before, although, oddly enough, Bruce Chatwin wrote a book there, used it as a hideaway. And we sat them down, gave them a gin and tonic or something, and then I looked for their bedrooms, and they were sagging mattresses and no running water. You had to have everything in buckets and things. And we gave them dinner and put them all to their various beds. And then I slept on the roof on a charpoy and was woken at about 5 in the morning by the peacocks on the battlements. And I got up, and there was India. And there was a little lake below us, and the local priest rowing out to do his puja, morning prayers, and the women with the brass pots getting the water. And I thought, my God, this is the real India. And slowly these people woke up and came down to breakfast. And bullock carts were arranged to take them to the various villages under the Zemindar's control, one that made silverware, one that made this, that, and the other. And they came to me after 3 days and said, we don't want to do any more tourism in India. We don't want to go to Agra. We don't want to go to Fatehpur Sikri. We just want to stay here because we're absorbing the country. We're as close to the country as we can get. And it struck me then, and I wrote a piece for Harry Evans in the New York Times just before he was launching Condé Nast Traveler, which employed the two of us for many years, I think. to say that there is some sort of a difference and that these people experienced it and were so much happier being travelers than being tourists.
So I might be tempted to say one British tourist equals a traveler from another country, because the British are inherently... I was, not to endlessly share anecdotes, but I was in Iran a couple of years ago, quite near the city of Bam, which was destroyed, of course, by an earthquake in 2003. And I was, my Iranian guide was always as close to me as Simon is. And I asked him innocently, have you ever been to Bam? And he said, I was there on the day of the earthquake with a British tour group in the worst possible conditions for a tour guide. And he said, suddenly in the middle of the night, the whole earth shook, the whole city was devastated, the two top floors of the four-story hotel collapsed, but luckily his guests were on the second floor. And he had to lead them by torch, flashlight, out from the collapsing hotel into the bus. And he led them into the freezing bus, and they were all sitting there at 4 a.m. as the light came up. And as soon as it was 7 o'clock, they were all from England, they said, okay, should we continue with our itinerary? The whole city had been devastated, but they were ready to...
Did you lay this on for us? It was terribly kind of you. Very spectacular.
Exactly, yes. Almost as good as a peacock on it in Rajasthan.
With your book, The Art of Stillness, it made me think that for Americans, perhaps more than anybody else, leisure is very strenuous. Leisure is exhausting.
Yes.
And we put ourselves to so much work as we travel, almost as much work as our actual work is. Mm. And can you speak to that and the idea of that sort of strenuous travel not being the opposite of work? It's something else altogether. Stillness is the opposite of work.
Yes. No, you're absolutely right. And I'm exactly like those people you were describing. When I go on a trip, I will punctiliously say, 7 a.m., I have to do this, 8 a.m., and I'll feel stupidly that when I go to Rajasthan, I have to see Agra, and I have to see the 10 great sites. But the redeeming grace of any trip is within an hour of arrival, you get lost. And within 2 hours of arrival, all your plans go out of the window. So although you're right, I plan my trips as if I were planning my work days. The beauty of travel is that you're much more at the mercy of the unknown and the unpredictable. And your preconceptions don't last very long. So in some ways, it shakes you out of that mindset. And indeed, when you are in India, and if you are hoping to go to Delhi and Agra, it's a safe bet that 11 hours will be spent waiting in the bus station. And as soon as the bus starts, it'll conk out anyway. So you're getting a crash course in waiting and not being able to run around.
So is it the sense that the control is out of your hands,
exactly,
and that you have to forfeit that model that you would use at the office?
And you are out of yourself. I mean, I think the beauty of travel is you're not the self that you are back home, ideally. Partly because when you or I are walking down a street in Havana, nobody knows that you have a radio program or that Simon has written books. They're just appreciating you in a much more essential way, and that allows you to do things and to be things you never would be back home, including maybe lazy.
And I love the fact that I particularly like going to countries which are so foreign, when you feel utterly bewildered, where you sit in a cafe, you don't know what the food is, you can't read the writing, there's no one to speak to in your language, you're completely lost.
Yeah.
And then travel becomes real, because it's invariably a positive experience.
But isn't that the defining moment between someone who is meant to be a traveler and someone who's meant to stay home?
I agree with you. Yeah. There's a moment of terror about how am I going to get back to my hotel? Where is my passport? Was there no one that speaks English here? This is ridiculous. And then you learn to live with it. Do you agree with the... I've not read your book, and I didn't come to your presentation yesterday. I'm desperately sorry, but I think we coincided. But
you were practicing stillness in your room, I think.
Probably, yes. Well, that's sleeping as well.
Yes.
But the Pascal, the famous in the Pensée, do you talk about that? That all of mankind's ills derive from his pathological inability to remain quietly in his living room. Do you agree with that?
I do.
Yes.
Yes. And he has a wonderful line about how we distract ourselves from distraction with distraction.
Yeah.
but to speak to what you were saying, I know a lot of people say, well, foreignness is gone from the world, because wherever we fly tomorrow, there will be McDonald's, a picture of Brad Pitt, and Starbucks. But I think it's just as terrifying and unsettling as it ever was. This afternoon, I will be driving back to Santa Barbara, And if I make a wrong turn when I get to Burbank, I will be in a place as terrifying as Port-au-Prince or Johannesburg. And I think actually that speaks to Pat's point about passports, because I think a lot of people, my neighbors in Santa Barbara, may feel the outside world is very scary. And the fact of the matter is, for most people in the world, it's Los Angeles that's a terrifying place, and that has really high murder statistics and a great places of anarchy and unrest. So in some ways, that liberates you for indeed seeking out the foreign, as Simon is describing, because it's right here, too.
The idea of it being increasingly difficult to go to places that no one else, no other person like yourself, is likely to be there was brilliantly encapsulated in the closing pages of A Short Walk in the Hindu Kush.
No,
remember, Eric Newby, great writer, dead about 20 years, I suppose, wrote a classic travel book about the Hindu Kush, the mountains in eastern or western Pakistan, eastern Afghanistan. And the two of them, Eric, who was in prisoner of war camp with my father, so there was some sort of familial connection, he and a fellow from the British Embassy in Tehran went into the utterly most remote part of the Hindu Kush mountains. And on the closing, the book is a wonderful story of their adventures getting there to a place that no human in their view had ever visited before.
I remember this, yes.
You remember the closing moment. So they're up in this mountain pass and they reach a relatively flat space and they decide, I don't know if you have these things in America, but in England they're called lilos, which are blow-up beds. And so they were on their knees blowing up their beds so that they could sleep softly in this rugged mountain terrain, and they heard the distinct sound of boots, of hobnailed boots, and they couldn't believe that there was another human being. But coming down this, it wasn't even a path, but coming like a sort of antelope or mountain goat, was a man, a tall, craggy man, and they recognized who it was. It was this indefatigable British explorer called Wilfred Thesiger. And Thesiger saw them, and you know, you and I would say, Pico, how lovely to see you, oh good Lord, Eric Newby, but he didn't recognize them at all. He looked at them, blowing up their rubber beds, and said, bloody pansies, and continued on the path. and I find that today. You endeavor to go to the most remote place,
yeah.
And you'll find a gap year student from the University of Birmingham doing study of the local Lepidoptera or something.
Well, all you have to do is see Mount Everest. You know, 60 years ago, Hillary and Tenzing were up there on their own, and now you see the trail. You know, practically something that you can do in a few days, and it's littered with, you know, Dorito bags all the way up and down.
That's a terrible.
And so that requires a different mindset, I think, to approach how to immerse yourself in the world when the world's invitation is becoming more like a theme park.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure you've got lots to say about theme parks.
Too much. But to go to what Simon was just saying, that wonderful story, of course, part of the excitement of any trip is meeting the people, and even the most unexpected people in the most improbable circumstances. So I was telling some people just yesterday, my wife and I have two things we really dislike, which are cold and the snow. So we went to Central Alaska in January, where the high temperature was minus 41 degrees. But one of the things we were doing, because we both live in rural Japan, was to see the other Japanese travelers. And they were fascinating, just like Wilfred Thesiger would have been. So we met this very small, mild-mannered matron who was telling us about participating in whale hunts with the indigenous people and carrying bloody whale carcasses across the frozen Arctic Ocean. We went in the middle of the night one evening to spend 4 hours trying to see the aurora, and there was a figure mysteriously stamping around in the dark. There were 14 people inside the room, and he just stood in this terrace for 3.5 hours, absolutely motionless, staring out into the dark and the emptiness and the snowfall of stars. And then finally, when it got time to leave, he came back in, and he looked like a character who steps right out of Lord of the Rings. He's very small, he had a wispy white beard, and he was Japanese. And we said, what are you doing here? And he said, I spent the last 45 years here just hunting wolves and bears. in the madness. And I said, because it's the polite thing in Japan when you meet somebody is to ask how old you are. And so I asked him that. He said, I'm 77. And he looked up at the heavens and he said, soon I'll be with you. Soon I'll be with you.
My gosh.
And, you know, you never see that in Japan. I've lived there in 30 years in Japan. I've never seen a wisp-bearded character who looks like a wizard from a fairy tale. So even though we never saw the Northern Lights in our week in Alaska, we saw our neighbors in a wholly different light. And we were glad to see Japanese people because they were very different from the way we would see them at home.
I was just thinking when you were talking about Alaska, I went to a much more modest literary festival in Skagway. Have you ever been to?
Oh, I was hearing about that.
This is this fjord, and the population of Skagway is about 600 people. And it's a slightly forlorn place, but they're very gamely, they have this literary festival. And every day, seven cruise ships arrive, disgorging thousands upon thousands of people who flood the streets. Magnificent mountains all around, I dare say lots of little Japanese hobbits looking up at the sky. But nonetheless, what is the number one question that is asked at the tourist office?
Where's the bathroom?
No. And it takes a little 10 seconds of thinking about what a ridiculous question is. What is the altitude of this place?
Oh,
they've
really?
Arrived there on a ship.
Yeah.
I sometimes worry about tourists.
Simon, you undertake such big topics in your books. It seems as though you have almost the scientific idea of taking the minute to apprehend the whole. You're not writing about every gallon of water in the Pacific Ocean or every atoll and island that you may encounter, but you do that writing of extrapolation. Is that a necessity that you've come to find in your books? And is it the way that you think does a good job of telling your experiences as they deal with what you encounter in the world?
Well, I believe, and I'm not trying to be self-effacing or unnecessarily modest or anything like that, I don't think my brain is big enough to make the kind of pan-oceanic remarks that students and writers of world history tend to make. You get the kind of book that other people would write about, let's say the Pacific Ocean, would be sort of ex cathedra declamatory remarks about the Pacific is this or the Pacific is that. But the only way that I can tell stories, and I think this is something to do with my having worked for a newspaper for so long, is to find stories within a big thing like the Pacific that seem to me to illustrate the ocean and the way it's going and to provide a sort of pointillist view. So I could never do it otherwise. I don't think I'm simply not clever enough to do it. So it's a convenient way and it's a fun way. You get to chisel away at individual stories. I mean, a wonderful story on Torishima, which is one of the islands south of Tokyo. Now, there's this long line of islands all to do with a suture in the tectonic plate south of Japan, where there was the biggest bird in the North Atlantic is the northern short-tailed albatross, which is not as big as the wandering albatross down south, but still, you know, it's an 11-foot wingspan and a body about as big as, not as big as you, but as a large child, as a Japanese hobbit with a beard, if you like. And they were essentially extinct because they were harvested on this island, Torishima, to provide pens and then the feathers for mattress filling. So there were six breeding pairs. Oh. And then this wonderful professor at one of the Tokyo universities decided it would be his life's project to go to Torishima, which is a very dangerous volcanic island anyway, to save the albatross. And he did. There are now 10,000 breeding pairs, and the bird is completely saved. And it's one of those heroic stories in which humankind can make a difference when all the stories about the Pacific environment, you know, with the bleaching of the Great Barrier Reef and the loss of various birds on Johnston Atoll and the fate of the Laysan albatross are bad news. And this was an item of good news. So to be able to try and tell the state of the Pacific through the fate of one beautiful, beautiful bird on this island in Japan, that's the only way I can do this sort of thing.
Mm. Pico,
do you tell stories like that rather than big?
Yeah, more human stories. I mean, you have a background in geology.
Yeah.
I don't, so.
Pico, Leonard Cohen died this year, and you write in your book about visiting him in is it correctly called, a monastery in California.
Very correct,
perhaps,
yes.
Perhaps you can talk a little bit about that experience and what it has to do with travel and with the stillness, the comparisons
that
we've been making.
And I won't talk too much about it because I see a few familiar faces who were in my talk yesterday where I talked about Leonard Cohen for 48 of my 50 minutes. But
don't worry, I won't let you do that.
I will, all of you who've been listening to him, remember that in his early songs are all about travel. He was a lifelong gypsy. He could never stay with a woman. He was a kind of apostle of restlessness as well as worldliness, constant movement. And suddenly, his movement kept on getting him in trouble. And starting at the age of about 35, he started spending time in Mount Baldy with a Japanese Zen priest who ran the Mount Baldy Zen Center. And then finally, he became a monk there for 5 years. And I think relevant to our topic, the main thing is he spent 5.5 years to sitting absolutely still, sometimes for as much as 18 hours every day, 7 days a week. And the result of that, as some of you may know if you saw his concerts in his last years, was that when he came back into the world, he had real energy and direction and movement. That, in other words, stillness is the first step to actually producing something and knowing what you're, where you're going in the world and being far more creative than if you're running in 1,000 directions at once. So he almost harnessed his energy through stillness, and then it came out in the explosion that happened when, as I was saying yesterday, after the age of 67, he released 5 new albums. He toured the world, gave 380 concerts in his mid-70s, and during those concerts ran on stage and ran off stage. So I think the reason I was talking about him yesterday was that most of us are involved in the business of balancing stillness and movement. And I feel I need to move and I need to travel to see the world and register what reality is. And I need to sit still to make sense of what I've seen and to turn my experiences and emotions into a kind of shape and into a meaning, to convert the sights into insights. But some of us spend too much time sitting in one place, as you said, 30% of people only having passports. And some of us, especially these days, are constantly running around. Even if we're sitting in one place, we're checking our messages, mm-hmm. we're doing whatever. So I looked to him as somebody who knew how stillness could make movement more purposeful and movement could make stillness more rewarding.
It's a curse of all writers that whatever you do, there's always a reaction in your mind as to calculating, is this a good story? Is this material? How do you travel without being a writer? Is it even possible that you can do it for your own pleasure?
I never go on holiday. I mean, I can't imagine. Yeah. I mean, life in a way is one endless holiday.
Yes.
It's just fun. My wife curses in a kindly sort of way. Why is it so much fun? I mean, coming, as you know, I was standing outside the Taj Mahal last Wednesday. And then
a likely story.
No, seriously. And then went to Delhi, to London, to New York, to Phoenix, to here. And it's been a wonderful week, and an amazing week. And next week, I go back tomorrow morning, and I won't travel for a little while. But it's endless adventures. And I sometimes think experiential overload is a problem. And I think that you are parsing so well in saying, you know, what is this world if full of care? We have no time to stand and stare. Mm. I find myself now, I live on a farm in Western Massachusetts, and there is a street, it's a dirt road, dead straight, and I find myself so often now just going out there and standing or experiencing what in Japan is called forest bathing, going into the woods, and with no agenda, no thoughts, no nothing, just immersing myself in the silence and the bird song.
Mm.
It's interesting, this is highly irrelevant, but I live on the top of a hill in the Berkshires in Massachusetts, and I'm quite keen on astronomy. So your snowfall of stars, lovely, lovely phrase. I bought this house in 2001, I think it was, and I was out, Saturn, you could see Saturn, so I have my telescope and I pulled it out. On this particular night, there was no moon, the sky was utterly black, just the stars were like, you know, diamonds on velvet, if you like. And there was no light pollution, there's a little town called Winchester, Connecticut, and you could see a faint glow in the southeast, but otherwise, total blackness, and I lay on my back in deep, deep snow, so I had lots of coats on, to look at Saturn for a couple of hours. And then I went to bed at about 3 a.m, and then the people that had previously owned the house dropped by the next day for a cup of coffee to say, how did you like the house? And I said, I'm so happy with this house, not least because of something that I discovered last night, which is that the sky here, there is no light pollution. It's perfect for astronomy. It's a wonderful place to be at night. And she said, well, maybe we should have told you this and extracted some more money from you. But in 1902, this house was owned by the Reverend Edmund Sears, who in this house in 1902 wrote the hymn, It Came Upon a Midnight Clear.
Oh.
Yeah. It was an amazing feeling.
Gosh.
Yeah, the connection with history. And of course, he was absolutely right.
Wow.
Yeah. Sorry, total irrelevance. I beg your pardon.
No, but and to pick up from what you were saying, well, of course, I mean, we as writers, we're lucky because we're paid. Well, these days we're not paid, but we're encouraged to sit still. Our job involves sitting still, taking walks, looking at the stars. But to go back to your question, Patt, the reason I became a writer is that I never normally keep a journal. But I took a long trip in my gap year when I was 17, and I honestly couldn't stop scribbling down because so many new impressions and experiences were happening every day. And I realized that the very fact of being exposed to the foreign actually forced me to write and made me spill over with things that first I wanted to share with myself and then inflict on my friends. And then I thought, if I'm inflicting on my friends, might as well inflict them for profit on strangers. But every now and then, both of us have Japanese wives, and every now and then I'll tell myself I'm going to take a holiday, usually with my wife, and we'll go somewhere, and I'll almost, you know, tie my hands together so as to avoid taking notes. And it's excruciating. And I get nothing out of the experience. I will spend most of the day watching CNN or ESPN. I'll come back exactly
ESPN.
The same person.
I don't see you as an ESPN.
I was up at 4 a.m. to watch Federer
tennis,
and Nadal,
right.
Remember, today. but one way or another, I won't give myself over to the place. And so I, in fact, just like Simon, I never take a holiday. And I will give myself an assignment, even if there's no editor at the other end. And as soon as I do, and I'll say, I'm going to write about looking for Japanese in Alaska, I'm out of the hotel room. I'm asking questions. I'm looking around the
corner. So you're task-driven.
I'm engaged. And so the fact of... So I always tell people it's a wonderful thing to travel with a camera or a sketchpad, or in my case, my iPad. But one way or another, it's really good to record things because you're going to get much more out of the conversation. And I think of it as a conversation between you and the place that you're visiting. And you're throwing yourself into it if you're on alert, ready to take notes and ready to speak back to it.
You used a phrase, and I wonder if you could elaborate it, making yourself familiar with the foreign. It seems to me that your familiarity makes it no longer foreign, unless that's the goal of going someplace that's so distant, so remote in time, place, or any other circumstance that you want it to be foreign.
Really? I think everything is foreign. My mother is foreign to me. My wife is foreign to me still, in the sense that I don't know what they're going to do next. I don't feel that I have a complete grasp of who they are. And that's the beauty of it. I'm constantly being surprised. You are foreign to me. We've talked briefly for a couple of times over the years. But I think knowing what is known is this tiny circle in this vast universe of darkness like the one that Simon is watching, and that's the beauty of it, that we never can get to the bottom of most of the things. And so there's always more to explore and more to question. Los Angeles is foreign to me, and even if it weren't, it would be changing by next week and would become foreign.
I find as I get older, I'm much more interested in the places that were previously familiar to me, and going back to them,
yes,
and re-exploring them.
Yeah.
And my absolute favorite place in the world, and has been all my life, at least the thing about reading geology at a British university is that you go and the United Kingdom is uniquely possessed of a very complex geology. It can be rightly said that every single horizon of geology from the early Precambrian right up to today is represented in Britain. So you don't have to go to a foreign country to see, you know, the Silurian or the Jurassic or whatever. And we were consequently taken on field trips, which were the envy of the world. Everyone would want to go to the places that we went, and yet they were only 200 or 300 miles away. And so most of our field trips tended to be in the west of Scotland. So they were on the Isle of Arran, and they were Skye, and they were Ardamerkin, and they were Ross and Cromarty. So I fell in love with those parts of the world. And I lived for a long while on a little island called the Isle of Ling, Ling being the Gaelic word for long, because it's a long island, and in a house called Ardnama. And I've never been happier. And I know in my heart that even though it's totally familiar to me, it's part of the United Kingdom, it's my country, that there's so much more for me to find out about it, and that's where I want to spend my last years. And much as I love the United States, and indeed I'm now an American citizen, both have dual citizenship, I will go back, I think. The call of the landscape of your youth, I think, in my case, anyway, calls back, so it has a sort of extraordinary magnetic appeal, and I will go back there and explore that, because, as you rightly say, that is still foreign to me, because there is so much more to learn about it.
It's also a place of extraordinary stillness. There's not much external stimulation other than the land and all the...
Well, and the weather. I love places with wild weather. That's why this is lovely, but I couldn't stand living here, because the weather... And indeed, I don't think where you live in California, in Santa Barbara, it's always beautiful. It's like that moment in Out of Africa, where she says, God, another beautiful day.
Yes.
Whereas in Scotland, you never know. You get up in the howling gale, and seagulls battering against the storm. That's what I like.
Yeah. The converse of what we were speaking of, the idea of the foreign, is people who travel and they see things that are familiar to them, the place from books, from movies, and yet once they get there, it's not remotely what they thought. Sometimes they're disappointed, and sometimes they're astonished and elevated by that I thought I knew this place and I had no idea. Mm. Can you speak to your experiences of that?
So I think the most fatal thing when you're taking a trip is expectation, actually. So I try and cleanse my mind of it for that very reason, because I think usually you don't know what to look for until you see it. If you go to Paris tomorrow, it's hard really to be amazed by the Eiffel Tower, as people might have been 100 years ago. It's very, very easy to be amazed by that bakery you've just discovered around the corner, or that beautiful French couple walking across the Jardin du Luxembourg, or whatever. Simon and I over lunch were talking about Easter Island, which I gallantly took my mother to when she was 70, because it had been her dream to see it since she was a little girl. And one way or another, it was very difficult for me to be swept away by the stone heads. But just this lazy Polynesian island with people walking down the sunlit main street very slowly, that was ravishing. And I think it was hard for me to see the stone heads because I'd seen or imagined them so much. But I think the beauty of travel is that even to really speak to all your questions, even the familiar things or the things you know become something radically different. And my rather silly example I sometimes use is that when friends visit us in Japan, I always tell them to go to the McDonald's. Partly because when they look on the menu, there is chicken tatsuta burger, there is moon viewing burgers in September during the time of the East Asian ceremony of the harvest moon, when McDonald's actually serves eggs in their burgers in honor of the moon. Then you turn around and you notice that most of the customers are young Japanese women dressed in Gucci and Dior and not what I see in the Santa Barbara McDonald's. And then you notice that everything about the way they're speaking and not speaking and covering their mouths when they laugh is entirely Japanese. You might as well be in the 16th century. And so you're going to a place you think you know and you feel is familiar, and it's made radically new and different to you. And I think whatever you're doing, going to a grocery shop in a foreign country, going to a 7-Eleven in China, it's going to be that's going to be charged with the unpredictable.
Oh, that's a very gratifying way to recalibrate how your brain perceives things.
Can I just address that in a way? Because sometimes you get an assignment which is utterly unpredictable and everything about it surprises you. Going back to Scotland, this island of Ling is north of Jura, where, oddly enough, George Orwell wrote 1984. And if I stood on my study desk, I could see the little hillock where he had his farm, called Barnhill Farm, and indeed we've named the farm in Massachusetts in honor of Orwell, whose book, incidentally, as you'll read, is suddenly selling again like hotcakes.
Number one on the Amazon bestseller list.
Yeah. Wow. That was all written in Barnhill. But
we'll have to write new blurbs for his
Yeah, we will, dear George. But there's an island called Scarborough, and between Scarborough and Jura is one of the world's great whirlpools. It's called the Corrievreckan Whirlpool. It's a lethal whirlpool. And I was passing it, I mean, you have to go through only, it's still water. And I thought, I wonder where the other great whirlpools of the world are. And I called the Smithsonian magazine, and I said, because that was in the days when they spent money like drunken sailors, and I said, could I go? And they said, yes. So I took a year and went to five of the world's biggest whirlpools. There's one in Japan, and there's one, the maelstrom, the famous maelstrom, at the southern end of the Lofoten Islands in Norway, Corrie Vreken, the one in Scotland, and two off the west coast of Sweden. And it was the best assignment I've ever had, and it was such fun. Whirlpools are ferociously dangerous things, full of myth and legend, and you get to sail through them all, and indeed the one at Corrie Vreken now, they have these boats with huge double Evinrude diesel engines, and they actually go right to the whirlpool so that you're being swept round and round and round, and then they can gun their way out of it. But
it's like a centrifuge in a way that flings you out at
really
some point.
Well, yes, but they don't tell it. You know, the Scots have this thing about tossing the caber with these great trees. Well, they would throw them into the very middle of the whirlpool, and they would be sucked down, and they've got little depth meters on them. They're sucked down 600 feet before they disintegrate. Very, very dangerous things. So I should commend to you, incidentally, I know we're not supposed to be talking about films, but my favorite film is the climax is set in the Corrie Vreken Whirlpool, and it's called I Know Where I'm Going. It was made in 1946 by Powell and Pressburger, and I guarantee you, anyone that loves Scotland anyway, and for a good old-fashioned love story, one of the great black and white films of all time, I Know Where I'm Going.
I've never heard of it.
It's, well, please, tonight,
Michael Powell and
Emmerich Pressburger who made it, Sorry, that's totally irrelevant.
I'm fascinated, though, by the nature of your assignments. Do you come up with them, or do your editors say, to use this example, Simon, you know, I've seen a whirlpool, and I'd like you to find me some.
Well, I'll tell you a story, if I may, about an assignment which went badly wrong. The magazine was The Atlantic Monthly, that's right. And there was a very nice editor there who rang me up must have been November, and this was in, I'm going to hazard a guess and say it was 2004 November, and he knew I was interested in weather. So we'd like to see the biography of a hurricane. So hurricanes, as you probably know, invariably start in Mali in West Africa with a little dust devil. And that moves out into the sea and becomes a bigger storm and then goes over the Cape Verde Islands, and then it gains energy. I mean, if it does, that's where it happens. And then it moves on across the Atlantic and gains more power as it reaches the warmer waters of the Gulf Stream and then becomes a hurricane. So I received this assignment with amazement and delight. They'd pay for me to go to Mali, pay for me to go to Cape Verde Islands, pay to Barbados, all sorts of places. I could take 6 months or so. Once again, this was drunken sailor time. And so I got all my visas and my shots and everything that I needed for this epic journey. And then in March, a new editor was appointed, and he pulled the plug. He said, you can't do it. Mm. So I was annoyed, irritated, but, you know, in this business, this
kind of thing. But were you stuck in the Cape Verde Islands?
No, and thank God one does not want to be stuck in the Cape Verde Islands. But what would have happened, had I done the piece, it would have been on the cover of the magazine in July 2005.
Katrina.
That was when Katrina hit. The point being that had it happened, people would have seen Katrina and that magazine would have flown off the shelves because it was a biography of how a hurricane happens. And I will not speak to that editor to this day. Such a missed opportunity.
Pico, how do assignments come to you, or do you?
I think these days I try to assign them myself. It's ever more difficult to find an editor to take it at the end of the process. But, of course, there are beauties when a wise editor will throw you an assignment to go to a place you never would have dreamed of wanting to go. But that happens less often than my intuiting that there's something there that I want to figure out and sending myself.
Which books have stayed with you as travel books? I mean, everybody here loves yours, but I'm thinking Bruce Chatwin's Songlines is one of my favorites. And Rebecca West, Black Lamb, Gray Falcon, which is 700 pages about Yugoslavia, and you reach the end, and for me, I thought, where's the rest of it? I wanted more, which was a testament to the writing as well as the substance of it. What?
That book has been on my list of books to read for ages, because so many people who've read the Rebecca West book say it's the greatest book ever. You're maybe the third or fourth person who said it, so I'd love to read it. Simon and I think, were both formed and inspired by really the greatest portraitist of places we'll ever see, Jan Morris. And there's still nobody who could come to Rancho Mirage for 4 days, go home and produce a sensual, analytical, deep, historical, human portrait of the place as exquisite as Jan Morris. And I think both of us, as young guys, wanted to be something like her.
Jan is the reason I'm a writer. I mean, I was going to be a geologist until I read her book, Coronation Everest, when I was sitting in a tent in northern Uganda in 1967 and wrote to him saying, "Dear Mr. Morris, I've just read your amazing book on climbing Mount Everest in 1953, and basically, can I be you?" And he wrote back, you'd think he'd ignore it, but he wrote a very kind letter saying, "If you can write, then my advice is to you, on the day you receive this letter, not next week, not next month, but the day you receive it, resign your job in Africa, come back to England, get a job on a local newspaper, and write to me again." That's exactly what I did. I went to the management. I had found, I was up there in the Ruwenzori Mountains looking for copper, and I'd been there a year and found not a microgram of copper. So when I said I'm going to resign, they were so happy. limousine to Entebbe Airport. And so I was back in London, November 67, I think it was, with all the sort of arrogance of an Oxford degree holder, thinking, oh, I'll breeze into a job. No one wanted to give me a job. So I worked on an oil rig in the North Sea for 6 months, applying for newspapers, got one eventually, and wrote to James again, because I now knew he was a famous writer. And I said, okay, so I'm now on a newspaper, what do I do? And there was this sort of gulp of, you took my advice. That wasn't. And he wrote and he said, all right, I'll give you three pieces of advice. Number one, and I know you, which is never lose your sense of wonder. Just because you as a writer are going to be exposed to places and people which will amaze you if you open your mind to being amazed. Don't become cynical or world-weary. Number two, don't bother to learn shorthand. Everyone will tell you you've got 120 words of Pittman shorthand. Nonsense, don't bother. And number three, and it was the kindest thing of all, every month package up your stories and send them to me in Llanystumdwy in North Wales, and I'll annotate them and try and turn you into a halfway decent writer. And as you can imagine, the early stories in Newcastle upon Tyne were four nuns in car crash, none hurt, that kind of thing. Pigeon fancier loses prize bird. And I would send them down to James, and he would annotate them, and, you know, this sentence a little heavy, this verb infelicitously chosen, and send them back to me. And under his tutelage, I became a better writer. And, of course, then I had no idea until we met that he was on the verge of changing gender, and we've been friends ever since. We've done a book together, and we're all friends.
But it's so funny, when you finally did become James, he'd become Jan. And the other book instantly came to my mind, sorry to interrupt you, was, I spoke about it yesterday, The Snow Leopard by Peter Matheson. And I think it's one of those bottomless books you can read again and again and get something different as you grow up and into it. But part of the beauty of it is it describes this extraordinary landscape that very few Westerners had ever seen, but also the inner landscape of anger and frustration and guilt and loss. At the same time,
I do want to get some questions. They must be questions.
Can I say one thing about the Rebecca West book?
Yes.
I think it's unreadable to me.
Really?
But the best book on the Balkans is called The Bridge on the Drina, and D-R-I-N-A.
Is that the bridge that was taken down during
No, it's not. That's another bridge. But The Bridge on the Drina is a perfect, perfect summation of everything in the Balkans. It's a novel, but it is a beautiful and I commend it to anyone.
Thank
I
you,
love
Michelle.
The Balkans, and please, anyway, sorry for interrupting.
So, we want it to be a question. Shout it out. I'll have to rephrase it anyway for audio purposes. About nostalgia and travel and memory and how shifty a thing memory really is.
So maybe I'll start.
Please, and
I think we often want places to remain exactly the way they were when we first saw them. And of course, they shouldn't, and they can't. I used to spend a lot of time in Cuba in the 1980s, when the only other travelers you'd see were North Koreans in pairs, wearing suits on a day hotter than this, with little lapel pins of Kim Il-sung on them. And I kept on going back again and again to Cuba. And finally, after six trips in 6 years, I thought, I'm going to leave it behind and never come back. Because this country needs to develop, and I want it to be the same lawless place it was when I first met it. And the analogy that came to my mind then is that sometimes if you meet a daughter of a friend and she's this lovely 11-year-old girl, it can be a shock to see her when she's 25, because of course she's not going to be quite as wide-eyed and dewy as she was initially, but she ought to have grown up, and it's just you who want to project who she was. The second part of it, very quickly, is exactly what Simon was saying about his island in Scotland, that the older you get, the more you feel tugged back to the places that originally formed you, and that's a more constructive nostalgia, because it suggests they are your deepest friends, and they're the ones with which you have unfinished business, maybe.
It's funny, when I drove last Wednesday from Jaipur to Agra to see the Taj, I went with a young woman who used to be, she's called Emma Skye, a very interesting woman who, despite being English, was the governor of Kirkuk in eastern Iraq under the coalition provincial authority. So she ran part of Iraq for a while. Now she teaches at Yale. Anyway, we were both due to fly back to Delhi, and she lives in Yale, so both coming back to America. But we decided she had never seen the Taj, so let's stop off and drive from Jaipur to Agra, see the Taj, and go up to Delhi that way. But on the way, and she had never been to India before, I said, what you're going to see is wonderful, unforgettable, but let me just take you to a village, because India, as Gandhi said, is her villages. So we turned off the road and went to some little itty-bitty village, and there was a chai stall with a young woman selling little earthenware pots of chai. And I said, we want, you know, tea, hot milk, cardamom, ginger. And the cows were there, and there was a dog, and it was sand and a straw hut. And we sat there for about an hour and a half in the sunshine. And it was one of those moments where you know you're happy at the time. Mm. It was an awful lot of happiness is nostalgic. My God, I was happy when I saw the Taj. And I was happy when I saw the Taj. But I said to Emma, I'm really happy at this moment. And I know I'll always look back on this moment as being happy. That's what makes travel. I think that goes back to this difference between tourists and travelers, because in their air-conditioned buses, they probably wouldn't have turned off to a village. Yeah. But having that tiny little experience with another human being who was Indian and was completely unfamiliar with our world was pure magic.
Oh, lovely.
Another question. Yes, right here.
When we travel, my wife takes notes as you do. I don't. We go back and tell our stories. This is the difference between fiction and nonfiction. Is there good fiction travel works? Have you written?
All right, let me ask, because we're running short of time. Good fiction travel works. You just mentioned the Bridge on the Drina.
Yeah.
I think a lot of the best travel is fiction. I think of John le Carré. I wouldn't trust any writer more about the external world than he, D.H. Lawrence. A lot of the great new young American writers are bringing the spices and smells of other countries right into our language and to our doorsteps.
And Simon, others besides the Drina book?
Golly. I think an awful lot of, I obviously love Kipling. I mean, I think still for the flavor of India, I know I talk a lot about India because I love it so, but I think Kim, one of the great, great travel books about it, and Men Who Would Be King, I think that was wonderful. So I'd stick with a lot of Kipling.
Quick, very quick question, one more, yes. Stand up and shout it out, please. Please, quickly. I'm so sorry, I can't hear you. No.
Irian Jaya, yes. Have I been? Yes. Did I enjoy it? It's tough. Indonesia generally is pretty tough, but very rewarding. And I'm not addressing Irian Jaya specifically, but I think to sit on the top row of, among the Buddhas on Borobudur and looking at those great mountains of, what are they called? Two big volcanoes, Merapi and Merbapu, they're called, and watch the sun come up between the two of them and the shafts of light reflecting on their slopes. Among the peace and the stillness of these Buddhas is one of the great experiences of life. If you've not done it, you'd love it.
The scientist Jared Diamond travels a great deal in New Guinea, so there might be some of his work you'd like to read to. It's scientific, but it gives a very strong sense of place. So I'd like you to please thank our panel, Pico Iyer and Simon Winchester.
Thank you.